I'm Micah Smith, and we're going to take a look at some of the top tips for newbie developers. To explain some of these concepts, I'm joined by Jon Stueve. Jon Stueve is a training manager here at Automation Anywhere. So Jon, what's the next tip?
Sometimes the bot's going to break. And if a bot's going to break, we need to know ourselves as we're building the bot, those places that are susceptible to breaking. Could be a web service is down or the website is slow or things like that. So you need to anticipate these places where the bot could possibly stop working. If it stops working in a place you're not expecting, then bad things can happen. The bot could pause. It could be stall the bot runner, make the bot runner unable to continue until other external factors do. So you need to understand how error handling works within A2019. It's vitally important. I usually wait until the end of building the bot and making sure my logic flows in a happy path. And then I start thinking about, you know, mad scientist, how can I break this bot? How can I make it just not know what to do? And that helps clue me in where to put in the error handling so I can have it fail gracefully, send an error message to a human that says, I couldn't do it. And then we can start taking mitigating factors for that.
When I'm talking to people about writing error handling for robotic process automation, one of the things I like to always coach them on is like, think about how a human would respond in this situation, right? If I'm automating on top of a web application and the application's responding slowly or the page doesn't come up at all, how does a human respond in that situation, right? It's probably a rule-based task that they've done before. So do they, you know, close the browser, clear a cache and reopen, or do they just wait? So think about that as you're starting to establish some of your error handling patterns. But definitely you want to make sure that you've caught every possible scenario when you're depending on these external apps or when you're depending on these UI-based applications. Make sure that you know how the bot is going to respond in these different situations. And then if it does have to fail, that it's failing gracefully, that I'm taking note of exactly why it failed, I'm logging that. And if appropriate, I might even be taking a screen grab just so that I can see exactly what the bot was seeing when it had that failure.
Another good tip as we're thinking about that, and find somebody to look at your code, because I don't see the errors that I make. It could be a misspelled variable name, which down the road could cause some more problems. It could be like, well, that's good, but we can reorganize it this way, and then you can see this benefits. So use that peer review to go through your code review checklist, something like that, and use the collaborative part of writing software rather than just sticking it in and I'm the only person that's in charge of this bot. It really is a collaborative group effort.
You know, I think that's a really great tip. When you're working with others, even if they're, you know, not more experienced than you or less experienced or either way, their perspective can be very valuable in helping you to come up with even newer ideas, right? And so even if you've both just learned RPA within the last 6 months, at least seeing the way that each other take on different problems can help you to really be the best, right? You can be the best of both of your solutions by understanding the way that they approach it, you showing the way that you approach it. And then you can really take the things that you like from both of those two approaches to make sure they have the best and most effective approach going forward.
The peer review process is not just a bug hunting exercise. It is a way to educate your bot developers. It is a way to collaborate better. It is a way to find new standards you need to improve. It is a teaching moment every time you have somebody review your code. It is not just a mechanical editing thing. It is a part to help people understand how code works. For newbies or for oldies, everybody can learn new skills. The other part about that, when we talk about, you know, making code reviews part of your development standards, goes back to error handling. Error handlers and how you range them should look the same. They should have the same sort of features every time you use it, because that creates a repetitive process for creating error handlers. It almost becomes like a factory when you start adding it. Here's the try. We're going to try to do these things. Here's the catch. This is where we can figure if an error occurs, this is where we're going to do some sort of data manipulation. And then finally, you could use the finally to be, this is where we're outputting data. We're writing to a log, sending an email, something like that. So that gives you the structure to look for when things happen. And you're not reinventing the wheel every time you do a new error handler. What I'd like to do is tell you about Automation Anywhere University. The website is university.automationanywhere.com, and it is our portal for all things learning. We have free courses, online self-paced courses for bot developer and citizen developers, as well as business analysts, so you can better understand what makes a good robotic process.
For more tips, be sure to follow us on YouTube. Be sure to follow us on our developer portal at developer.automationanywhere.com and on Twitter.